nation, and he shall come again.
Morning, everyone.
Morning.
Merry Christmas to each and all of you. It is wonderful seeing so many of you, actually, on Christmas morning. I was not expecting this large of a crowd, so thank you for gathering here on this special morning. And we'll begin with, we will sing the Advent song one more time, because this particular line talks about the lighting the Christ candle. So please join me for that. Please remain seated as you sing.
Good morning.
Morning.
If you'll join me in the call to worship as found on your screens. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God.
Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Let the seas roar and the mountains quake.
Everything came into being through the Word. What came into being was life, and the life was the light for the people.
Sing to the Lord a new song. For God has done marvelous things.
The Word became flesh and blood and lived among us to bring all people to the light.
Let heaven and earth break forth into joyous song, singing praises to our God.
The light shines in the darkness, and darkness has not overcome it.
Christ our light.
Let us worship. Alleluia. And if you'll pray the opening prayer with me. Incarnate One, we bow before you on this day to celebrate the coming of your presence among us. You are the fulfillment of God's ancient promises, a living testimony to God's faithfulness. We thank you for your life-transforming love. You are a gift of sustenance to souls who hunger and thirst. You are the balm to the wounded and strength to the lame. You are the very light of God, shining for all the nations to see. With all creation, we rejoice at your coming as we worship before your manger. Amen. And our opening hymn this morning is Angels We Have Heard on High. You find the words on your screen. If you're worshiping with us in the sanctuary this morning, you can also find it on page 238 of the United Methodist Hymnal in your pews. And if you'll stand as able as we sing this morning.
Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly.
good morning to each and all of you, and once again, Merry Christmas. It is always a blessing for God's people to gather, but especially on this special morning. Please, we now like to go together to God in a time of prayer. Well, this morning, I just wanted to especially lift up the Littleton family who are here in attendance. Stephen, our prayers are with you as you remember your father. And please let us know the coming arrangement, and I'll make sure that I'll let you all know. Please remember all the Littleton family in your prayers. And I know that you, each of you, might continue to have prayer concerns or requests, either for yourself or those whom you love. So we like to lift those up during the time of prayer as well. But also, may we open our hearts that we might hear, we might embrace the message God is speaking to our hearts this morning. Let us pray. Oh God, we give you thanks on this cold but beautiful morning. Thank you for calling each and all the persons out of many different walks of life to gather here so that we might be able to celebrate together as God's people the birth of Emmanuel. God is with us. Thank you for coming in the form of the Christ child and continue to be in our lives, guiding our steps. Thank you. May we always remember that Christmas is not just one day, but the same Christ will continue to be in our lives, continuously shaping us, reshaping us, so that we might continue to become the people that you have called us to be. So please be in our lives. Fill our hearts with your love and with your peace. And continue to guide our lives each and every day. And may we also boldly go out to the world to share the love that we know, so that people around us might also find your love and your abiding presence in their lives. God, thank you for the family and loved ones who might be gathering today or during Christmas time. May you bless each and all the persons whom we love and continue to guide them in a special ways. And thank you for your ongoing reminder that we are loved deeply, truly, and forever. May we always hold on to that promise and live each day boldly, courageously, faithfully. God, we are here this morning with many prayer concerns, requests, or petitions that we may carry in our hearts. So now we like to lift those up to you, either out loud or silence in our hearts. Lord, hear our prayer.
Gary Weimer.
For the people of this church.
Palmer Smith, Judy Kinnear, and Sharon McCartan.
For my family.
As we sit here warm, safe, and well-fed, we pray for those who are neither warm, safe, nor well-fed.
God, thank you for hearing our prayers. We trust that you answer them in your special way, in your timely manner. God, this morning we continue to lift up brothers and sisters who might be facing health challenges or any other challenges in life. Those who grieve, especially we lift up the Littleton family this morning. And those who are facing transitions or any decision making. All those, like Reverend Charles said, who are in a place that are cold or unsafe. All the persons who might be feeling lonely. Just ask that you cover each and all God's children here and throughout the world and embrace them as beloved children so that we might all find your love. And this morning, we especially lift up Greenwood Church and each and all the persons who are part of this community. Thank you for guiding our lives. We just ask that you will continue to do so, so that we will faithfully fulfill the special plans that you may have for each of us. May we always be faithful to you, both as individuals and as a congregation. Again, pray for this community, country, and the world. So much is happening locally or in our own lives throughout the world. We witness so much violence, war, injustices. So I just ask, especially on this day, but every day, may your love be shine brightly so that all the person, all God's children, throughout the world might discover your amazing love and abiding presence in our lives. Now, so the people of God, let us now come together and pray together the Lord's Prayer, the prayer Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and power, and glory forever. Amen. So now I'd like to invite each and all of you to stand, if you're able. And may we together recite the Apostles' Creed. Words be on the screen or 881 of your United Methodist Hymnal or the program that you have. May we together say what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From then he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Now I'd like to invite adult children choir?
The adult choir and the children.
Adult choir and the children. All right. For our special music this morning.
This is the first time that we've tried it all together. Ladies, or children, can we come back here?
Thank you.
round of applause. Yay, great job. Well, so proud of each and all of you. So it's Christmas. We're going to have to do something fun this morning. So I'd like you to pull out the sheet, the caroling sheet. I know you, all the children and all the people who have gone to caroling a couple weeks ago, you know, you might be familiar with it. So why don't we just go ahead and sing some carols together? And I'd like to go ahead and take the request. Whoever wants to sing, you know, we're just going to, she's going to hit it with the music, and we're just going to sing. How's that? Who would like to go first? Request? Which one?
Rudolph.
Rudolph. All right, it's on the first page. Good start.
People passing, we smile after smile.
So it came upon the midnight clear on the other side, I mean the next page, on the in the kind of in the middle. I know everybody have special memories for Christmas, But just for the next few minutes, if you have a special Christmas that you like to share with the whole church family, anybody? I know we like to going on forever, but maybe if you could just make it concise and just tell us.
My grandmother on my father's side, who was involved in the church her entire life, played the organ in the church for 68 years, always made Christmas so special for us. And her silk ornaments on the tree with the revolving light, if anybody remembers that, going around and around, and then packages that just came out almost to the whole room, just showed us on one day her generosity, her caring, and her love for all of us. And it wasn't about the packages, it was about her.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Molly.
Mine wasn't just one Christmas, but something I remember was when Charles had one church that they had a late service started at 10, so we usually didn't leave for my daughter's house till midnight, and we'd get there about 2 o'clock. And the next morning, I didn't really sleep that good, but in the next morning, about 5:30, 6 o'clock, I'd hear the kids out in the hallway, and they'd be saying, "Mom, can we open them yet? Can we open them yet?" And they'd say, "No, not till Grandma gets up."
Yeah. Who's in charge? Grandma is. Yeah.
I got a lot of presents.
All right. I am so glad you were so excited that Santa was coming. Yes, I'm glad. All right. Anyone else, like a special Christmas that you always remember and cherish?
I was 4 years old, and in my family on Christmas Eve, my father was from Germany, so we did the Christmas Eve. They opened all their presents Christmas Eve, and I still hate that. Anyway, it was time for me to go to bed, and everyone was there. I mean, I'm the youngest of 8. And so the house was packed, and I didn't want to go to bed. So I begged my mother to let me stay up, and she did. And she gave me, she thought this would put me to sleep. She gave me a wine spritzer. And I became the belle of the evening. I still remember. It was wonderful. It was just wonderful. Everybody was there. I love my family so much. They're all gone, but that's my favorite memory of Christmas. Sure.
Memory continues to live on. Yeah. So, yes. Yes.
Well, we had a lot of Christmases to remember. Of course, with our children and then our grandchildren. But today is going to be a little special again. For today, we will have the first Christmas with our newest great-granddaughter and our great-great-granddaughter. And Mr. Michael will have it with his great-great-great-granddaughter. So that'll be a Christmas today to remember.
Sure.
Thank you, Ed. Sure is. Six generations, right? Yeah, that's doesn't happen all the time, so that's such a blessing. Anyone else? Maybe I'll take one more.
Because of the time. The children are definitely a blessing. The Christmas program was fantastic. You guys did so good, and you make Miss Tammy so happy. Going Christmas caroling with the church is just fantastic. So I love all of you guys so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Tammy. Thank you so much for sharing your special memories. And that Tammy's comment will bring us to a quick children's message. I just want the only thing, I'm not asking any of the children to come up, but I'm speaking to all God's children here. See, I see a lot of smiles despite the challenges and all the tough things happening in our lives. And I can see that you are touched by God's love. And I was wondering, if we could continue that spirit all year long, probably the world might become a better place. So the challenge is that for us receiving the message of Christmas, how could we share that with others the rest of the days of the years? So may the love and peace of Christmas be with you and grow within you each and every day. Thank you.
Reminder that your tithe and offering might be mailed to the church. Online giving option is now available
please come Ashley for questions. And if you're worshiping here in the house, there's an offering basket placed at the back of the sanctuary. Please now join me as we give back those gifts to the Lord. Let us pray. Oh God, thank you. Thank you for your love and the many gifts that you give in many different ways. And thank you, most of all, the greatest gift that we have received, the Christ child. You came in a human form. May we always remember your love and special blessings in our lives and never take them for granted, but receive them with the hearts of thanksgiving. It is time for us to bring those gifts back to you. We pray that you will bless the gifts and use the gifts for your glory. We thank you, we love you, and we continue to serve you all days. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So now please, as we prepare our hearts, may we pray the prayer for illumination together. Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen.
Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the book of John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overtake it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. This is the Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you very much, Connor. I may have mentioned a long time ago, but in our household, Friday night had become a movie night. And I have to admit, Friday is not the greatest day for me because I started feeling that the pressure going into Sunday, oh my message not ready, and I got so much to do and all that. So a lot of time I'm grumpy, I admit. But anyway, but it's supposed to be a fun family time, right? And anyway, a couple Fridays ago, we watched a 2012 movie called Argo. Can anybody have seen it? Oh, good, good, good. I see some hands from this end. Okay. So it was based on a historical event. I try not to get into the details, but I'll just explain the outline for you so that you might get the idea. On November the 4th, 1979, Iranian militants stormed the U.S. embassy in Iran. And 66 embassy staff were captured, while six managed to escape, and they are housed in the home of Canadian ambassador. So now CIA had to come up with a plan to rescue them because it was a matter of time that they would find out and capture them and they might execute them and all that. So they have come up with some plan. Why don't I fake in them as that they are teachers teaching in local schools or they are missionaries or something like that. But those ideas are deemed impractical. Tony Mendez, which is the main character of the movie, an actual person who passed away a few years ago. Anyway, he came up with an idea. We'll make him a Canadian film producers looking for an exotic location in Iran to shoot their new sci-fi film. So Mendez contacted his former colleague, who now worked in Hollywood as a makeup artist. And he contacted a film producer. So together they came up with a fake movie production company and a movie. And not only that, they promoted that movie that it's coming so that people would know in, as a public knowledge that this movie is coming, right? Anyway, now then, so Mr. Mendes flew to Iran, met with the hostages. And now they have to do their part. They have to become Canadian film crews. Each person was given pseudo name, pseudo life stories, where they're from, and which school they went, or whatever, whatever. And a profession. You be the screenwriter, you be the cameraman, that kind of things, right? Making a long story short, all six of them were able to safely get into the plane to Switzerland and return home. All right. I didn't bring up this film just to promote the movie or give high five to Ben Affleck, who, did the movie or anything. But the takeaway for me is this. In order for this operation to be successful, each person or each related party have to fulfill their part. Of course, Mr. Mendes, but his fellow staff at CIA back in the United States, his friend in Hollywood, he need to buy into that idea, and he needed to contact the film producer, and he need to be on board of what's happening, right? And of course, Canadian ambassador and the Canadian government, for that matter. And of course, the hostages themselves. They have to believe that this plan work, and they have to truly become another identity so that the whole thing will be pulled off without any danger. Because one misstep could endanger their lives, but more people's lives. I believe the same can be said in Jesus' birth story, God coming to the world. Think about it. What would have happened had Zechariah and Elizabeth, so parents of John, didn't believe that their son, the promised son, would prepare the way for the coming king? Or even before that, what would have happened had they not believed that they were going to have a son, because both of them are old? In the same way, what do you think would have happened had not Mary said, "Let it be with according to your word"? Had Joseph not done just as the angel of the Lord commanded him? What about the shepherds? Would the Christmas story be different had they not believed that, hey, let's go see this newborn king to honor him, to celebrate the birth? What about the Magi? What would have happened had they not taken another road home, but went straight back to Herod? So if you think of that way, the birth of the Emmanuel was able to happen as it did because of all the people around him. All the faithful people, I would say. And if you think about it, God seems to have worked out God's plans in and through the faithful people throughout the scripture. For example, like Abraham. He had all life settled in one place. Now, 75 or whatever years old, he decided to pick everything up and decided to go to a place that is unknown to him. Just trusting God's word. I'll show you when you get there. What about Moses? He fought because he could not speak well. But with God's help, he was able to become a leader for his people, rescuing all the people out of Egypt. Think about it, all the prophets, judges, kings, disciples. Yes, they had flaws, shortcomings, but they took certain role in the stories of God and God's people in the world. So the question to you this morning becomes, what is our part in the story? I know that we have just finished the Advent study, and if you have attended that study or read the book, you might know the story. But there's a legend that goes like this. God ordered the group of angels for a special performance. God said to them, this is a very, very special song, so you got to practice hard, which they did. They practiced hard. You know, they have becoming better and better each time. And then they learned that they, as hard as they worked, they get to only perform that song once. What? But they've worked hard anyway. And then one day God said, it's time. Oh boy, had they sung so well, so powerfully, so beautifully. They were so proud of themselves. And then one gutsy angel, of course there's always one that's gutsy, right? Stood up and asked God a question. Why, God? Didn't you hear? We have done such a wonderful job. Why? We can only sing this very special song one time. God smiled and said to them, because the Savior, my son, has been born, and now earth must do the singing. How would you do the singing? How would you share the good news that Christ is born, that God came as one of us, and the same God will continue to be in our lives, guiding our lives through the ups and downs of life each and every day? How would you share that story with others? This DVD of the Advent study that facilitator said, your name is already printed in the book. How would you sing this great news? How would you share the love of Christ with others? May the love and peace that you are remembering this morning, may that grow within you, sustain you when the hardships face in our lives. And may you always be faithful to God's guidance in our lives so that you might fulfill a special part in God's plan for the world. Thanks be to God. Amen. So as we close this morning's special worship, may we sing together the closing hymn, which is There's a Song in the Air. Words, again, will be on the screen, or if you choose with the music notes, it's 249 of your hymnal. Please stand as you're able and join in singing. Amen. May the peace of Jesus Christ, love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you, go with you, and always give you peace. Amen.
Don't forget to like and subscribe.